This is The Herd, Hour 2. Wherever you may be in, however you may be listening, live in Los Angeles, iHeartRadio, Fox Sports Radio, FS1, Joy Taylor is joining me, Hour 2 in 15 minutes, less than 15 minutes, about 12 minutes. Albert Breer stops by, Sports Illustrated, Monday Morning Quarterback. This guy's got the very latest stuff on the Jets coach, the Browns coach, Mike McCarthy, Brian Kelly, Notre Dame, Cliff Kingsbury, a lot of stuff happening right now in the NFL. In about 12, 15 minutes, we'll give you all of it. Joy, how are you?
Doing great.
All right. There is a difference between being honest and a hater. If I say Cam Newton's moody, that's being honest. It's not being a hater. If I say Baker Mayfield's short and a little cocky, that's not being a hater. It's,
well, short is relative.
Well, for NFL quarterbacks, he's short. He's a shrimp for NFL quarterbacks. But the point is, there's a difference now in this everybody gets a ribbon life, that if I'm critical, and I tell my son all the time, be a critical thinker in life. Like, see ahead, look for the trends. Don't be the guy that reacts, be proactive. Russell Westbrook's in LA tonight to face the Lakers. People think I hate Russell Westbrook. No, I don't. Russell Westbrook is a good guy. He gave a lot of money to UCLA for a practice facility. He's a good husband. He's a good guy. I think he's well-meaning. I also think he has no self-awareness. It's that Carmelo Anthony thing. He's got no self-awareness of what he is. So Russell Westbrook has had a terrible year shooting. And yesterday, playing the Lakers tonight, yesterday, I mean, his shooting numbers right now are awful. Field goals, he's 37th. Three-point percentage, he's 68th. Free throw percentage for a guard, he's 65th. He's having a terrible shooting year. He's never been a great shooter, but now he doesn't have the pop because he's had multiple surgeries. He's aging, and he doesn't elevate like he once did. The shots are not as open, and he's never been a great shooter. But he said yesterday, it doesn't matter, I'm so good at a bunch of other stuff. Here you go.
Scoring the basketball is not the only thing I can do. I'm the best rebounder in my position, the best passer in my position, the best defender in my position.
Okay. Now, first of all, he's not the winningest point guard or the best shooting point guard. That stuff matters to me. That's why I prefer Steph Curry. But let's break down his claims. Number one, he's the best rebounding guard. Congratulations. That's like being the best pass-catching right tackle. Cool, bruh. Let's go to number two. He's the best defensive guard. 10 years, decade, not a single all-NBA defensive team. In fact, he is largely mocked for not guarding his men on threes, being closer to the basket. Therefore, he can elevate his rebound stats. There's video proof we're showing on FS1. Number three, he's the best passing guard in the league. Oh, that's adorable. Yeah, that's why Kevin Durant left. You were such a great passer. This is what drives me crazy about him. He has no self-awareness. There's not a single executive in the league that thinks he's the best passing point guard. There's not a single executive or analytic in the league that tells you he is the best shooting, passing, defensive point guard. What he is a hyper-athletic, aging quickly, wildly dynamic, streaky, unpredictable fourth quarter point guard that can't shoot. He's not a bad guy, nor is he a bad player. I'm not even contending he's a bad teammate. He has no self-awareness. And that is a really important thing in sports, knowing not only what you are, but what you're not. Russell Westbrook's in LA tonight. LeBron's hurt. Oklahoma City will come into town. They'll win that game. And oh, by the way, the Oklahoma City Thunder, if you've watched them at all this year, and I have already made it fairly clear who they want taking shots late in games. Paul George is now their best player, their most dependable player, their most reliable player, and their most clutch player, and frankly, their best player. Westbrook, Lakers, tonight in LA. I should just go. Not even heckled.
You're going to go and get those fancy seats?
Yeah, I don't know. We'll see.
What do you think Russell will have to say?
Russell would know I was there. He would, but he would not acknowledge it. He'll have a good game. They'll win tonight. Okay. What I'm going to talk about for the next 3 or 4 minutes is something that I believe in life to be true. I'm a quality guy, not a quantity guy. I've never, nothing against buffets, Nothing against having 30 slices of pizza. I'd rather have 3 great slices of pizza. I'd rather have a great cocktail than 9 cheap beers. I'm not into more. I'm into good. And in college football this year, if I have to hear another, we've got to have an 8-team playoff. Everybody gets a ribbon. We need more teams. Really? I watched all these bowl games. Yeah, I watched all these bowl games. And you tell me what you saw in these bowl games over the last 3 weeks that told you we needed an 8-team playoff. I would argue we should have a 2-team playoff. Alabama-Clemson next decade. I watched that number 3 seed Notre Dame, who you argued for, get blown out. I watched that number 4 seed Oklahoma fall behind 28-0. I watched the 5 seed Georgia last night, who you lectured me deserve a spot in the playoff, basically get pushed around for 3 hours. I watched Michigan get clobbered, UCF get clobbered against the SEC's 4th best team missing 14 starters, and I watched Washington fall behind 28-3, make it competitive, but not in the same league as Ohio State. Come on, man. When has more ever been better? We don't need more teams. Fewer equals special. Fewer equals urgency. Fewer equals better. There's never been a club invited. The more people they let in, the cooler the club. Listen, I would change college football, and all my changes would be fewer, not more changes. My perfect playoff college football scenario is keep the current 4 playoff teams, then only 8 other bowl games outside of the playoff. That's your top 20. That's it. No conference, meanwhile, can have more than 4 bowl teams. And what that does is ensure regular season games matter. The SEC and the Big 12 put 7-8 teams in the bowl games. Now it's down to 4 max. That late season LSU-Kentucky game, that late season TCU-Oklahoma State, that's like a bowl game. That's like a bowl game. 4 teams per conference max to bowl games, 8 bowl games outside of the playoffs, and then the playoff. And that would ensure 3 things: regular season urgency, bowl game urgency, and playoff urgency. We keep looking for more. Give me more of this and more of that. You ever watch like CNN's political coverage? They got 40 people on the desk. You know who's a star? Oprah. One person. You know who's a star? Howard Stern. I don't want 30 people. Give me 1, max 2 people talking on television who are smart, have context, and can add. Every show I watch, it's jam more people, more political people, more sports people, 19 people on the draft. How about 3 who know what they're talking about? I don't need to see UCF and Michigan and Washington. And I'm watching these games. Why do I want to see Alabama crush 3 teams instead of just 1? I don't want to watch Alabama blow somebody. They led Oklahoma 28-0. What would they lead Washington, UCF, Michigan? We got to get – do you want sports to be – you know why the NFL's king? Because the regular season matters and the playoffs matter and the Super Bowl matters. That's why the NFL has surpassed the NBA in baseball. Regular season's too many games, playoffs too many teams, then the finals are good. College football needs less of everything. Fewer teams going to bowls, fewer bowls, not 8, but just 4, maybe 2 teams in the playoffs. All right, buy, sell, or hold. Albert Breer is going to be joining us next. We got playoff games coming up. We have coaching openings. We have young star quarterbacks, your Bakers, your Sam Darnold. Who's going to be their coach? Jim Harbaugh, Brian Kelly, they coming into the NFL next. In LA, it's The Herd.